Praise the Lord. So here's what you got to do this morning. You got to encourage me. My voice is pretty strained right now, as you can hear it. The first service, I strained my voice a bit. It's pretty emotional. It's an emotional time. If you think about it, what's going on around us, what happened yesterday here in Buffalo, New York, that was just terrible. I can see the national headlines now. It happens in Buffalo. What good can come out of Buffalo? Listen to me. I don't know why somebody would come from Binghamton, that's where I grew up, and come here to shoot people. I was just out in the foyer. A lady came in, and I've known her for quite a few years. She doesn't attend church. She's really befuddled. Loves people. She picked up Pastor Bill and brought him here. Loves people. She's been all over the world. Loves people. Can't figure it out. I can't figure it out. She said, I saw you the other day somewhere, Pastor, and I just wanted to run up and talk to you, but she didn't. But she did in our foyer. And she said, I don't know what's going on. She said, why would people kill people just because they're a different color? And I said, it's not about color. It's about the heart of man. Do you know man's heart is evil and it is wicked? There is wickedness in the heart of man. There's a sickness in the heart of man that somebody would do something like that. The only way I can describe it is sickness. I spent 2 days last week with Dr. Darren and doctors from other places and visited many of the drug rehab places in Western New York. I have to tell you, I am completely ignorant when it comes to that sort of thing. I don't know much about it. I couldn't believe what I saw. I couldn't believe what I saw. The different places we went, Stu, I couldn't believe it. It just opened my eyes to something that's right here around us. It's just hidden. It's deception. It's deceiving. We went to Kids Set Free, where they have kids housed from all over Buffalo, Western New York. And drug addiction, young kids, your sons and daughters, young people, total bondage to drugs and alcohol. And the overseer of the Kids Set Free sat with us, and he set a bag out in front of us, and he took all the stuff out. I didn't recognize any of it. Bongs and whiffers and sniffers. And he put on a sweater that had a, looked just like a regular sweater with a string that came around it. It was a hoodie. And in one pocket, there was this vaping thing. And the string went around like this, and he picked it up. And it was a hose that a kid could suck on and vape, and nobody would know that he was doing it. He showed me a package, and it had cartoon characters on the front of it. Bugs Bunny, those kinds of things. Kind of a fun-looking package. He said, this is meant to attract young people. And he said, inside this package is a form of marijuana that's 83% HTC. 83% in 1960s, when it came from Vietnam, it was about 1 or 2%. That would knock you on your butt. He said, this 83% will send a kid into schizophrenia. Schizophrenia. And you can buy this. Do you know, church, listen to me, East Aurora is going to be opening a store down here, and they're going to be selling this stuff to your sons and grandsons. In fact, I talked to my grandson, who you teach, and I said, what do you think about that? He goes, Pop, that's nothing. He said, I see it at 93%. He said, most of my friends, he said, I can't go to a party that it's not there. He said, I was sitting at a party, and everybody in there was doing whatever they were doing, and I heard his voice talking to me, calling me. I turned around, and there was nobody there. I said, what do you think? He said, I think God was telling me to get out of there. How many of you know our sons and daughters need to get out of there, don't you think? How are they going to get out of there? The only way they're going to get out of there is if somebody shines the light in there. Now, who's that going to be? That's going to be us. We're the church of Jesus Christ. We're equipped. We're salt and we're light. But unfortunately, our light is dim right now, church. Do you know that Western New York, they did some kind of a survey or something, and we came out number one in the country in biblical illiteracy. In Western New York. You think there's a root cause of what's happening in Western New York? Do you think that God's maybe trying to tell us something? That there is coming to this area a revival. I believe it. unlike anybody has ever seen before. I believe Western New York is going to see a revival. Why not Western New York? Something good can happen here, church. And it's us. It's you and me rising up and becoming all that God has created us to be. And the only way that's possible is if we open ourselves up and we stop quenching the Spirit of God moving in our lives. Come on, somebody say amen. Help me out here, church. We have to open our hearts and our lives to the moving of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit wants to move in us. He's the only one that can bring people to Jesus. No one can say Jesus is Lord without the Holy Spirit. Did you know that? It doesn't matter what you say to somebody. You're not going to bring them to the knowledge of Christ. You will not do it, no matter how persuasive you are. You won't do it. The only way that's going to happen is if the Holy Spirit brings that person to the knowledge of Christ. Amen. And renews them in Jesus Christ. We need that in the church. We need that moving of the Holy Spirit. Paul warns us in 1 Thessalonians 5:19 to not quench the fire of the Spirit. But so many times we do that and we don't even know it. So many times I do it and I don't even know it. I don't allow the Spirit to flow. We need the Spirit of God to flow. That's the only thing that's going to make a life change in somebody's life. Do you believe that? Come on, do you believe that? It's the only way that that's going to happen. In Mark 13, verses 5 to 13, listen to what Mark writes, or Jesus talks about, and Mark writes in Jesus' words. Jesus replied to them these words. Listen, can you put that scripture up? Is that in your PowerPoint? Maybe not. Okay. Jesus replied, "Don't let anyone mislead you. For many will come in my name claiming I am the Messiah. They will deceive many, and you will hear of wars and threats of wars, but don't panic." Everybody say, don't panic. Don't panic. Don't go out and buy yourself a gun, arm yourself to the teeth. Come on. Don't go into your cave and hide out someplace and say, it's all coming down. Don't panic. Yes, these things must take place, but the end won't follow immediately. Nation will go to war against nation and kingdom against kingdom. And there will be earthquakes in many parts of the world as well as famines. But this is only the first of the birth pains with more to come. We're in birth pains right now. That's what I told the lady in the foyer. I said, you haven't seen anything yet. I asked her a question. I said, what do you think can resolve this issue that you're seeing? Can the Democrats, the Republicans, can more laws, can more restrictions, take away all the guns, take away everything? Can that do it? Will that make it better? And she said, no. I said, it's not going to get better. Jesus has to come back. That's the only way it's going to get better. And it says he's coming. That's what I was saying to her. He's coming. You need to be ready. He is coming. He's returning to this world, and he's going to make everything right. All the things that we can't do, he will make right. Verse 9 says, when these things begin to happen, watch out. In other words, be alert. Wake up. Fill your lamps with oil. Be ready and be on guard. You'll be handed over to local councils and beaten in synagogues. You will stand trial before governors and kings because you're my followers. Remember, he's talking to Jewish believers during that time, the Jewish disciples. But this will be your opportunity to tell them about me. So in the midst of all that persecution, what's his expectation, church? What does he expect of us? To run and hide? He says, no. He says, this will give you an opportunity to tell them about me. When hard times come, when terrible times come, when things get bad in your schools, when things get bad in your neighborhoods, when things get bad in your family, around you, the people you love are touched by these things that are happening. It's an opportunity for you to stop and tell them what the hope is. That's the opportunity. The door is open. It's amazing, isn't it? I walk out of the first service, go into the foyer, and there she is, standing right there. I was looking for you. What am I going to say? Well, I'm busy. I'll be back. I got to get ready for the second service. I'll be back. Just hang on to your questions. No! It's an opportunity to tell somebody about Jesus. So don't panic. Don't go inward. In the 1960s and 70s and 80s, there was a charismatic renewal that swept through the country. And it birthed the non-denominational church. That's what happened during that time. It was essential. It separated the denominational church and the non-denominational church. And out of that came Crossroads Christian Church and other similar kinds of churches. Non-denominational churches that were able to move and flow in the Holy Spirit, that were not restricted by traditions and theology of man. And it created free worship. The songs we sing right now, they all came out of that time period, and it's been growing ever since. Let me ask you a question. Do we need another move of the Holy Spirit in the church today? Do we need that today? Sure we do. What could God do if there was a mighty blowing wind fire of the Holy Spirit in the church today? What would that look like? What would the result of it be? What would the impact be? It's coming, church. Before Jesus comes back, it is coming. God is not done. He is not finished. He didn't go, I made a mistake and I created this thing called the church, my bride, and she's just dysfunctional. He's not coming back for a dysfunctional bride. He's coming back for a bride that has been made ready, and it is filled with the fire and the power of the Holy Spirit of Jesus Christ. In his name, amen? Somebody say amen. Come on, help me out here. It's happening. He's coming. It goes on in Mark, verse 10. For the good news must be preached to all nations. But when you are arrested and stand trial, don't worry in advance about what to say. Just say what God tells you at that time. Don't worry about what you're going to say. Don't write your notes out and worry about what you're going to say. Just allow God to flow through you. For it is not you who will be speaking, but the Holy Spirit speaking through you. The Bible says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Whatever fills your heart will come out of your mouth. If the Holy Spirit fills your heart, guess what's going to come out of your mouth? It's not going to be blah, 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 blah. It's going to be so profound, people are going to look at you and say, you're not smart enough to think that. And I'll say, amen, I am not smart enough. You hear me ever say that? I am not smart enough to think those kinds of things or to say those kinds of things, but it's the abundance of the heart that the mouth speaks. We need to be filled to overflowing with the Holy Spirit. Verse 12, it just gets worse. A brother will betray his brother to death. A father will betray his own child. Children will rebel against parents and cause them to be killed. Everyone will hate you because you are my followers, but the one who endures to the end will be saved. You know what that tells me, church? It tells me we're going to have to endure some things. That's what it tells me. It tells me that we're not going to get away from this just because we go hide and we seclude ourselves from things. We will have to endure some things, some more than others. And that'll depend on the amount of grace God has given you, because God will never allow you to be tempted beyond what you can bear. Do you hear me? He's going to not allow you to get into a situation that you can't bear up under. Depending on the grace that he gives you, you will endure. As God gives you that grace, and your grace only comes through the Holy Spirit. How do we endure? The only way we can endure is through the power of the Holy Spirit. That's it. You can't grit your teeth, plant your feet, and grrr. I mean, I like that, because that's the kind of person I am. Some of you are like that too. But that doesn't work when you try to endure that way. Don't panic. Don't worry. The Holy Spirit will come and will fill you and help you endure to the end. Paul, on his mission trip in Acts 19, he tells a story about what he saw. It's absolutely amazing. Listen to what it is. Apollos was in Corinth, and Paul traveled to the interior region until he reached Ephesus on the coast, where he found several believers. What's a believer? Tell me, what's a believer? somebody who believes in Jesus Christ, right? So he found people, look at me, he found people that heard the message and believed in Jesus. But that's as far as they had gotten. Okay, they hadn't gotten any further. So watch the story, how it develops, and watch how they come to face-to-face with the Holy Spirit, because a lot of people are like that. In just a moment, I'm going to tell you a story that happened to me like that. So here they are, believers, okay? And so he gets there, he found the believers. And then he asks them a question. Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed, he asked them. Now, we all know that when you believe, you receive the Holy Spirit, right? The Holy Spirit comes and dwells in you, you become the temple. So they must have received the Holy Spirit in order to believe, because nobody can come to Jesus but by the Holy Spirit, through the Holy Spirit. So they had to have the Holy Spirit in them. So did you receive the Holy Spirit? Good question, right? No. Bad theology. That's a joke, right? No, they said. They replied, we haven't even heard that there's a Holy Spirit. A lot of people in the church today, they hear the message, give your life to Jesus, give your life to Jesus, come to know Jesus. Salvation's important. You want to go to heaven? You need to have Jesus. But they never hear about the Holy Spirit. That could be for us today. Holy Spirit? You mean that? You mean the drip, 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 drip? The water? You mean, I've heard stuff like that. But no, nobody's told me. I'm going to tell you all about the Holy Spirit this morning. Amen? You are not going to leave here biblically illiterate about the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name. Say thank you. All right, good. That helps. Then he goes and he says, well, then what baptism did you experience? And he asked, and they replied, the baptism of John. John's baptism was before the cross of Jesus Christ. It was a baptism for repentance. Okay, it was opening the way for the coming of the Messiah. Okay, it was not the baptism after salvation. It was the baptism before salvation. Okay, so Paul says, John's baptism called for repentance and sins, but John himself told the people to believe in the one who would come, meaning Jesus. As soon as they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. We had 54 baptisms in the name of Jesus here in the church, right? Those are the baptisms of Jesus, the baptism after salvation. And it says, and it goes on and it says, and then Paul laid his hands on them, and the Holy Spirit came on them. They spoke in tongues and prophesied, and there were about 12 men in all. I got a lot of questions to ask about that. Who were they prophesying to? What was the language they were speaking? And why was there only just 12 men? Now, here's the good news. Next week, we have a special guest coming up here to explain all this to all of us, and her name is Dorald. My wife, and she's going to sit here with me, and I'm going to ask her some of the hard questions about that, and she's going to tell us all about what this means, speaking in other languages and tongues, because you know what, truthfully, that freaks out a lot of people. And right now, I'm freaking out some of you. You're saying, where is this guy going? I thought I came to a sane church. Listen to me. I don't do crazy. Okay? I'm too blocky for that. I'm 74 years old. I'm a German-Irish. I'm blocky. I do not do crazy. Most of the time. My wife may disagree with me. We'll tell some stories about crazy. Some of the things we've seen is unbelievable. How God moves and what he does. You know, so they were baptized in the water and baptized in the Holy Spirit. Never heard about the Holy Spirit. 41 years ago, I became a believer in Jesus. I was a believer. Lived in a small town of 1,500 people. There was a couple of churches, and neither one of the churches really taught or shared much about the Bible. So mostly what I learned by reading the scriptures. We had one radio station in Cherry Valley that reached our area of 1,500 people. There was no internet. You couldn't go on and type in Holy Spirit or anything like that. So I was really kind of feeding myself during that time period. Doral, my wife, was not a believer at the time. We were going through some pretty major struggles. And then one day I was driving around the area and I heard on the radio that there was a men's retreat at Lake George, a full gospel businessman's retreat. Remember that, Joe? And that was going strong, right? And so I heard that, and the Lord spoke to me and said, you need to go to that. That was okay, but here's the problem. That Saturday, that weekend of that retreat was the same weekend they had the Richmondville Day Parade. That was the big event of the year. All the kids that played baseball got dressed up in their baseball uniforms and their little hats, and the coaches walked, and they had flags, and all the fire trucks came out. They had a big chicken barbecue and all those kinds of things. Well, two of my boys were on baseball teams, and Doral's father was the coach. Do you think I should be there watching the parade, standing along the sidelines clapping? I'm a dad. I never miss a parade when one of my kids are in a parade. I don't miss it today. My son played high school basketball, college basketball, and in 8 years, I missed one game. I'm like there. I looked at Doral and I said, I can't be there tomorrow. She said, what? You're not going to work. And I said, no, I'm going to go to Lake George. There's a men's retreat. I need to be there. And remember, she was not a believer at the time. She said, you're crazy. She was livid. That means mad. In my world, it means bad. It means like really awful. How many of you would like to have a livid Doral on your case, right? Well, let me tell you, it wasn't good, Trey. It was grandma on steroids mad. You know what I'm talking about, Trey? Yeah, right? It was like really a tough time for me. I said, but I got to go. And I remember driving up there in my truck. I had a little Ranger. And I'm driving up there arguing with myself. What are you doing? You're crazy. You're nuts. You're crazy. Go back. It's not too late. You turn around right now, you can make it. It was early, early in the morning. I get there. It was about 8, 9 o'clock in the morning. I walk into this auditorium. It's filled with people. It's 2,000 men at least. It was packed. I stood back against the wall like this thinking, you're crazy. What are you doing here? And all of a sudden, the guy in the front said, you in the back. And I'm going, no, you in the back. And one of the ushers came up and said, he's talking to you. He wants you to come up here. I went from the back of that auditorium, yeah, to the front of the auditorium. I'm standing there like, I got to go home. These people are crazy. Thinking to myself, what am I doing up here? Talk about embarrassing, Trey. You think that was bad the other week. This was embarrassing in front of all these people. And they began to prophesy over me what was going to happen in my small town in the region where I was from. These guys didn't know me from anything. And they're telling me that I'm going to go back and I'm going to plant a church and something's going to happen and the fire of God's going to fall. I said, you're crazy. I'm going home. And the guy said, have you ever been baptized? I said, no. He goes, let's get you baptized. They'd already planned this out. A lot of people were going to be baptized. Right out the door, right out to Lake George, right out to the water. Took me, dunked me under the water in the name of Jesus Christ. Brought me back up and said, you ever been baptized in the Holy Spirit? I said, I don't even know what the Holy Spirit is. He said, we're going to baptize you in the Holy Spirit. God's going to fill you with his power. He's going to fill you with the power to go and witness to him. I came up speaking in other tongues. I had no idea what happened to me. There was no teaching. There was no preparation. It just happened like that. And I got to tell you, the fire of God fell on me and dried me off. I was on fire for Jesus. I didn't know what hit me. I got overtaken by the Holy Spirit. I got in my truck. I'm driving home. I'm going home. Totally different. I stopped at the first toll booth, got out, gave the guy a hug, gave him a banana, and said, Jesus loves you. Got home, walked in the house, and said, Doral! She's going, you missed a parade. Doral, I'm baptized in the Holy Spirit. I speak in tongues. How many of you don't tell an angry Doral something like that, right? She'll explain it all next week. But that's what happened to me. And it turned my life upside down, turned my family upside down. Doral became a believer, and God used us to plant a church. We saw revival through the area, signs and wonders and miracles. All of her family got saved. Why? Because the Holy Spirit empowered us to speak His word, broke the bondage over life. In the Bible, there's three baptisms that every believer ought to have. Every believer ought to go through. Three baptisms. Did you know there's not just one? There's three baptisms. There's first the baptism of where the Holy Spirit comes and baptizes us or immerses us into Jesus Christ at the time of salvation. He comes and He makes us part of the body of Christ. How many of you know that we need the church of Jesus Christ? When you come to Jesus, your most desperate need, the most desperate need you have is to be part of the body of Christ, to be part of the family of Jesus Christ. The thing that bothered me most about Christians before I became a believer was they called each other brothers and sisters. I used to think that was the stupidest thing I ever heard. They don't even know each other, and they're coming up going, "Hi, sister. Oh, it's so good to see you." And they don't even know each other. And when I became a believer, right away I realized that He's the Father, and you're my brothers and sisters. I got this big thing called a family. I'm connected all over the world to this thing called a family. That's when the Holy Spirit immerses you in Jesus Christ, makes you part of the family of God, and you come to this amazing revelation that this thing called the kingdom of God isn't just about you. You're not alone. Come on, somebody say amen. You are part of the body of Christ. It doesn't matter where you're from, what nation you're from, every tongue and tribe and nation, we're all brothers and sisters. The whole world is open to you. I go anywhere in the world and hug somebody and say, "Hi, brother, hi, sister." Doesn't matter anymore because they're all my brothers and sisters because He's the Father. That's the Holy Spirit baptizing us into the body of Christ, into Christ, immersing us. That's what baptism means. It means to immerse in, immersing us in Jesus and as in the body of Christ. There's a second baptism, and that's the disciples' baptism. That's what we did up here, 54 people. We baptized the disciples. Who's a disciple? You're a disciple. Why did I do all the baptisms? Why don't you go do the baptisms? You think I'm more of a disciple than you are? We're all disciples in Jesus Christ. Can't you go and baptize somebody? Go find a mud puddle and baptize somebody. I was in India with a guy, and that's just what we did. We baptized him in a mud puddle. I'll never forget that. We took water from the ground, and we put it on his head in the streets. He said, "I want to be baptized." It's not the amount of water, it's the heart of God, that none should perish. Everybody come to the knowledge of Jesus Christ. It's taking somebody into a deeper commitment to Christ. It's saying to that person, "Listen, I don't know where you came from or what you did in your life past, but that's all gone. That's all gone. It's dead. It's there in the waters of baptism. When you come up, you're a new creation. Now go and serve the Lord. Go and baptize other people." And then there's a third baptism, and that's Jesus' baptism. Jesus baptizes us in the Holy Spirit. Did you know that? Jesus baptizes us in the Holy Spirit. In Matthew 3:11, it says this, "I baptize you with water," John says, "for repentance. But after me will come one more powerful than I, whose sandals I'm not fit to carry. He will baptize you." Who will? He. Who's he? "He will baptize you in the Holy Spirit and with fire." Do you see that? Three different baptisms, three different purposes. The baptism of the Holy Spirit in fire, the baptism of Jesus Christ is a baptism to empower you to walk out your salvation through an overflowing of His grace in your life, through your life, into all the world. That's the purpose of that baptism. It's to make you an effective witness to Him. Listen, you can witness to Jesus Christ. When you become a believer, even without the baptism of the Holy Spirit. You can witness to Jesus Christ. Let me tell you how it works. Her name is Dorald. So I invite all these evangelists up to my house for dinner. And I put her right in the middle of the table, and it's all set up, sick 'em. Do you know what I mean? One of those deals. It's called shoving the dove. The Holy Spirit's the dove, right? It's called pushing her into salvation. How do you think that worked? Ask her next week. It didn't work good. I remember when they got up and left, you know what she said to me? I'll never forget these words. Don't ever do that to me again. She just liked it. Don't ever do that to me again. She said, you left me alone at their mercy. Now that's an ineffective way for a believer to try to witness to another believer. And then there's a believer who's filled with the Holy Spirit. How does that believer witness? So I come home, I say, Dorald, I'm filled with the Holy Spirit and I speak in tongues. I said, and the Holy Spirit told me this. The Holy Spirit said to me, leave her alone. She's mine. I said that to her. So I'm going to leave you alone. You are all His. It's between you and the Holy Spirit. You will not hear the name of Jesus from my lips again until you ask me. She'll tell you. That was one of the most terrifying moments of her life. Because all of a sudden, she was face to face with her God and not her husband. That's effective witnessing in the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit speaks to you and tells you how to witness. And tells you how to share. Tells you what to say and when to say. When to shut up and when to stop pushing. So that baptism of the Holy Spirit will empower you to live your life in grace. Will empower you to be an effective witness into the Holy Spirit. Into effective witness for God and for Jesus Christ. Listen, interestingly, there are only a few things that are mentioned in all four Gospels. Did you know that? Not all four Gospels mention the same things. Some give different parts of some different events that took place. But there are four things that are mentioned in all four Gospels. So I figure this way. If they're mentioned in all four Gospels, they're probably pretty important, don't you think? And do you know what those are? The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. How many of you know the cross of Calvary is essential to our foundation as a believer, right? And then there's another fourth thing, and that's the baptism of the Holy Spirit. That is mentioned in all four Gospels. Guess what? That means it's kind of important, don't you think? Let me read these to you. Most of them are the same until you get to John. John's gospel is written after the other gospels are written. Some years later, John has a lot of thoughts on what he's seen and things like that. So he puts things into a little bit different context. So we'll read his last. In Matthew 3:11, okay, this is John the Baptist speaking. He says, as for me, I baptize you with water for repentance, but he was coming after me is mightier than I. I am not fit to remove his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. You see that? Holy Spirit and fire. Puts those two together. Mark 1:8 says, I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. He leaves out the fire. But he says, I'll baptize you. I wonder why, when I get to heaven, I'm going to ask him, why did you leave out the fire? You know, did you get burned somewhere or what? What's the deal? Put the fire in there. Okay? In Luke chapter 3, verse 16, it says this. John answered and said to them all, as for me, I baptize you with water, but one who's coming who is mightier than I, and I'm not fit to untie the thongs of his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. But now watch what John says. He expands on it a little bit. Then John gave this testimony. He said, I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him. So something happened. He saw something happen. He saw the Spirit come and remain on Jesus. I would not have known him except the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, 'The man on whom you see the Spirit come down and remain is he who will baptize with the Holy Spirit. I have seen and I testify, this is the Son of God.'" Here's what's interesting. Until Jesus' baptism in water, the Holy Spirit never descended and remained on anyone in all of the Scripture. In the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit would come down and then it would lift. Or it would come down and they would prophesy. They would do a sign and wonder and a miracle. It would come down and David would pick up a rock and kill a giant because he was anointed with power and the Holy Spirit. It would come down and Samson would tear the gates off of a city and carry them away. And it would lift when he got his hair cut because he was living in sin. Saul, King Saul, the Holy Spirit would come down. He would prophesy. He would lead the armies of Israel into victory. And then as soon as he sinned and he went into witchcraft, those kinds of things, the Holy Spirit lift, and a demonic spirit came down and filled him with a demon. In fact, David, when he sinned and had sexual relationship with Bathsheba, his cry in Psalm 51 was what? "Take not your Holy Spirit from me, but restore unto me the joy of my salvation." So what was he crying out to God for? He's saying, "Don't take your Holy Spirit from me." So the Holy Spirit comes, descends on Jesus, rests on Jesus, and it remains there. And it never lifts after that. When you give your life to Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit comes. He descends on you, and he remains in you. You're born again, born from above. But there's much more than just that. There's much more than just the indwelling of the Holy Spirit in you. Yes, you're the temple, but there's much more. There's the overflowing of the Holy Spirit. That's the baptism of the Holy Spirit, where God pours his Holy Spirit into you and it just bubbles over top of you, and the grace of God flows through you and out through you into all the world. That's the baptism of the Holy Spirit for the purpose of serving, for the purpose of glorifying God, and for the purpose of being a witness into all the world that Jesus Christ is Lord. Amen? Are you with me? Look like I left you somewhere. We're all in the talking about the overflowing of the Holy Spirit that needs to take place. Do we need that today, church? Sure, we need the Holy Spirit to remain on us, yes? Right, Aaron? But do we need that overflow of the Holy Spirit? Do we need that baptism of the Holy Spirit? Absolutely. We're in the last days and we need it. The book of Acts, throughout the book of Acts, shows us the three different baptisms, but it focuses primarily on the baptism of the Holy Spirit. In Acts 1, verses 4 to 5, Jesus was getting ready to leave his disciples and he said these words to them. "Once he had eaten with them, he commanded them, 'Do not leave Jerusalem until the Father sends you the gift he promised. As I told you before, John baptized with water, but in a few days you'll be baptized with the Holy Spirit.'" So when the apostles were with Jesus, they kept asking him, "Lord, has the time come for you to free Israel, restore our kingdom?" He replied, "The Father alone has authority to set those dates and times. They're not for you to know, but you receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. You'll be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere, Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the ends of the earth." And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and with power. And they began speaking in other languages and other tongues. And in Acts 2, 14, Peter steps forward. He comes out of the upper room and the disciples are all prophesying and praying in the Spirit in tongues. And he comes out and the people think they're drunk. And he says, "They're not drunk. They're just fulfilling the prophecy of Joel." Listen to this prophecy of the Old Testament about what's going to happen in the last days. Verse 17, Acts 2, verse 17. "In the last days," says God. Are we in the last days, church? Yeah. We're in the last days. "I will pour out my Spirit upon all people." Are you all people? Yeah. Sure. "Your sons and your daughters will prophesy." Your sons and your daughters will prophesy. How'd you like to see that? Oh, I could tell you a story about that. Todd's sitting back there. I could tell you a story about what happened way back. Sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Do our young people need a vision for life and for their future? Sure they do. They need a vision. And this is the part I like. Your old men will dream dreams. I figured it out this morning. I don't sleep solid for more than a few hours. I'm awake, I'm down, and I dream all the time. Man, I've never dreamed so much in my whole life. I've got all these memories and all these things, and I'm constantly dreaming, wondering to myself, what does that mean? Verse 18, in those days I'll pour out my spirit, even on my servants, men and women alike. Men and women alike. And they will prophesy, and I will cause wonders in the heavens above and signs on earth below, blood and fire and clouds of smoke. The sun will become dark, the moon will turn to blood before the great and glorious day of the Lord's arrival. But everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. That's exactly what happened in Pentecost. The Holy Spirit was poured out on all people everywhere. We need that today. Let me ask you a question. I'm going to close with this question as the worship team comes forward. Why would you not receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit with fire? Why would it be okay? Look at me. Why would it be okay for the book of Acts? Why wouldn't it be okay for us today? Why would you reject or hold back from receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit with fire? What would be the reason why? I think it goes back to Genesis chapter 2 and 3 in the garden where man sinned. There were four deadly sins that took place. The first one was doubt. Doubt was like this. Satan came and said, did God say? You know, that could stop you from receiving the Holy Spirit. Did God say? I mean, is that really in the scripture? Did God say that's for me? Or is that just for them? For those of the past. Is that for me? I don't know. I kind of doubt it. So there's doubt. That'll stop it. Amen? Will that stop it for you? It probably could. Or how about pride? Pride. Take and eat of that fruit because you can be like God, knowing good and evil. There's so many people in the church today that are so theologically proud that they reject the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Because they got it all wired. God's spoken. I've got everything I need from God. I have the Holy Spirit dwelling in me. Why do I need this baptism of the Holy Spirit? It just doesn't sync with my theology or my understanding of God. You shut off the Holy Spirit. You grieve the Holy Spirit. You quench the fire of the Holy Spirit because of doubt or pride. Or how about the things of the flesh? It's called the lust of the flesh. It looked good. That fruit looked good. So they said, well, I'll eat that fruit. A lot of people today in the church would rather comfort the flesh, take care of the flesh, than go through the sacrifice that it requires to walk in the Spirit and bear the fruit of the Spirit. It happens all the time. They make a decision. This is how I'm going to live my life. I'm going to live my life half in and half out. Listen to me. You can't do that with the Holy Spirit. He does not play around like that. He's the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. He will not flow through or overflow through a vessel that's living in sin. The flesh, that'll do it every time. The flesh. Or how about fear? So they ate the fruit and then they heard the footsteps of God coming into the garden. And they were afraid. So they covered themselves up. And then it says they went and hid amongst the trees. A lot of people will hold back the Holy Spirit or the moving of the Holy Spirit because they're afraid. They're afraid of what they'll even look like. You know, me praying in the Spirit, prophesying in the Spirit, me dancing in the Spirit, me doing all those. What would people say? What would they say if they saw me like that or doing things like that? And so they hold back because of fear and they don't allow the Holy Spirit to be released into them and to all the world. That'll stop it. You know, when God planted the Garden of Eden in the east, it's called the Garden of Delight. And the Bible tells us that there was a river that came in and watered that garden. Imagine what that river was like, pure. You could dip your head in it and drink from that river. And the Bible says that when it left the garden, it went into four headwaters. I believe that those headwaters, you can find them today, out of the scripture went north, south, east, and west. Why was that so? Because God told them that I want you to live here with me. I want you to know me intimately. I want you to be filled with me. I want you to walk with me in the cool of the day. And then I want you to be fruitful and I want you to multiply. I want you to go and rule over all creation. Take what's in the garden, out of the garden, and fill the world with my glory. That's why it was there. But the rivers that flowed meant to carry the spiritual nature and image of God. But because of the sin of Adam and Eve, they were cast from the garden. And instead of that happening, doubt filled the first river. And doubts filled our world today. Did God say, is God real? Isn't there doubt everywhere you go? Amen. So one river was filled with doubt. Another river was filled with pride. Pride and arrogance. Bad theology and those kinds of things. And another river was filled with lust of the flesh that floods through our world today. And then fear. We experienced that in the last few years. Fear filled that river that was meant to flow with the fresh water of God's Spirit. Here's the good news. Jesus came and he said, I'm going to get rid of all that. He said, I'm going to start all over again. I'm going to make you my garden. I'm going to put my seed in your heart and you're going to be my garden. You're going to be my delight. Do you know that? Every time I see you, I'm going to delight over you. I'm going to sing over you. And I'm going to fill you with the Holy Spirit. In John 7, Jesus said, if you're thirsty, if you come and you drink, if you come and you drink, and if you believe me, you believe in me, then out of your inmost being will flow streams of living water. That's the rivers that will flow out of us into all the world. That will remove the doubts and the fears and those things that are destroying our country today. But we've got to be thirsty, church. And I don't know about you, but I've seen enough in the last week. I am really, really getting thirsty. I need the Holy Spirit, so do you. We need a flow of the Holy Spirit. We need a release of the Holy Spirit in this church today. Do you believe that? Do you believe that? I want you to all stand. We're going to sing a closing song, and then I'm going to come back up. And I'm going to invite you forward for ministry. We're going to be singing a song that talks about being thirsty. It talks about being overflowing with the Holy Spirit. I want this to be your prayer. And I don't know about you, but if somebody's going to come and give me a gift, I'm not going to stand there like this. I'm going to reach my hand out to receive it. If I got a gift coming from my Father in heaven, I'm going to reach my hands up. I want to receive that gift. Amen. I think this is a good time for you to stop worrying about what the person around you is going to look at if you lift your hands. Get your hands up into the air and receive the gift of the Holy Spirit in here this morning. I got to tell you, the first service, it was absolutely amazing. The Holy Spirit fell in this place, and I believe the Holy Spirit will do it now if you're just thirsty. Are you thirsty, church? Are you tired of seeing what you're seeing all around you? You want to make a difference. You can't do it by yourself. You can't endure to the end. You can't make it without the body of Christ, but you need the overflowing power of the Holy Spirit operating in your life and through you. Let His rivers flow. Let the streams flow. Get rid of all the doubt. Get rid of the fear. If you got sin in your life, repent of it. Ask God to forgive you. Stop doubting God and receive His gift. He's the Father, and He gives good gifts to His children. He wants to give you the gift and the gifts of the Holy Spirit. He wants those to flow in your life, and you need it today. Make this your prayer, and I'll come back up. Sarah?
And all who are thirsty, and all who are weak, come to the fountain, dip your heart in the stream of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of His mercy as deep cries out to deep. We sing, come Lord Jesus, come.
You come in this place in a special way. Holy Spirit, bring the anointing that breaks any yokes of bondage over any of our lives. Set us free to move in the Spirit. Set us free to allow us to release the gifts of the Spirit into our homes, into our lives, the places where we work, into the villages, into the surrounding towns, and into all the world. That there are streams of living water flow through us. Holy Spirit, come and fill us to overflowing. Jesus, baptize us in the Holy Spirit. Baptize us, Lord Jesus, in the power of the Holy Spirit, we ask in your name. Amen. Amen.